Welcome back to Language Center, our series on Milestone Texts, Preface to the Lyrical Ballads, Part 2. In this video, I'm going to explain a short part of the preface. That's where Wordsworth states his object in writing the poems in Lyrical Ballads. So what was his plan when he wrote the poems for the Lyrical Ballads? That's what he explains here, and I will explain my takeaway. Okay? First, his statement. The object was fourfold. That means we have to remember four points about this objective. One, he was planning to choose incidents and situations from common life. Common life as defined by Wordsworth operationally as humble and rustic life. Almost interchangeably he used these two. Common life as rustic life. So that was the first part of the object. Incidents and situations are chosen from rustic life, common life. Second, to relate or describe them as far as possible in a selection of language really used by men. That was the second point. I will explain each after listing them. Third one, to throw over them a certain coloring of imagination whereby ordinary things should be presented to the mind in an unusual aspect. And then fourthly, to make these incidents and situations interesting by tracing in them the primary laws of nature, chiefly as far as regards the manner in which we associate ideas in a state of excitement. Okay, so this is how he gives a list of the four points about his objects, and we shall consider them one by one. First, the first about the incidents and situations. We know, and Wordsworth states, incidents and situations are taken from common life, and I told you for Wordsworth, common almost means the same as the rustic, the rural, the village. So rural life is taken. Why? He gives reasons. Four reasons are given by Wordsworth. We have to consider them. One, the essential passions. Each of these terms need explanations, I know. The essential passions of the heart find a better circumstance for full growth into maturity and also get opportunity for free and frank expression. That means it is in the rustic life that the essential passions of the mind grow naturally, and it is in that condition that these essential passions are expressed freely and frankly. So the point is very clear. There is an idealization of the rural. There is an idealization of the village in contrast with the urban. So in villages, we get opportunities for our essential passion. So that also is a question. What does this phrase mean? Essential passions. Wordsworth does not make a clarification whether he refers only to the elementary feelings, that is a term he uses later, or only emotions as contradistinguished from feelings. So that is not a distinction here. He simply generally uses the term essential passions. And if we strictly take them as emotions, we can correlate them with the basic idea of Cartesian philosophy, because in Cartesian philosophy there are certain emotions, six of them are taken as essential. Essential means essential to humans. So universal human emotions in Cartesian philosophy are six, which are they? Love, hate, sorrow, joy, desire, and wonder. We can compare and contrast this with Indian aesthetics theory of rasa, in which first eight bhavas and correspondingly eight rasas are listed, and then one added, nine bhavas and nine rasas. But quite unlike that, in European traditions, in the Cartesian philosophy, these are the six ones, quite different from the Indian patterns. Love, there is no such a thing in Indian aesthetics. Riti and Sringara, you may feel, you may see, but not love. Here, love, hate, joy, sorrow, then desire and wonder. So these are the six essential passions, and Wordsworth does not clearly state he means, but it is likely that they may be. Anyway, the essential passions of the heart find a better soil for their growth in rustic condition of life. So in city life or in an urban life, emotions are complicated, emotions are corrupted, or because of social manners and other things, emotions do not flow spontaneously. That is the idea of Wordsworth, not mine. So in rustic life, these emotions grow. Not only that, they grow in our minds into their maturity, but we get opportunities for free and frank expressions. Village people, rustic people speak their emotions frankly, freely. So that is the first reason their life is taken for poetry, because of this originality of emotional life. That's number one. Then there is another reason why this rustic life. In that condition, that means in rustic condition of life, the elementary feelings coexist in a state of simplicity. That's what he says. I'm just quoting him as such. Elementary feelings coexist. Again, elementary feelings, what do they mean? Most likely, perceptions related to our senses. So these basic elementary perceptions, they coexist in a state of greater simplicity, and consequently may be more accurately contemplated and more forcibly communicated. That means we can contemplate on our feelings easily in a rustic life, because they are in their elementary forms, coexisting in their simplicity. So we can identify them and we can communicate them more forcefully, these feelings. That's the second reason. There is again no sophistications in the feelings. Then third reason, the manners of rural life germinate from those elementary feelings and from the nature of rural occupations. They are easily comprehended, understood, and they are more durable standing. That's the third reason for the choice of rustic life. That's a very controversial looking statement. He says, the manners of rural life are durable, means long standing. What does it mean? The behavioral manners, the social manners of rural life are more permanent when compared with the urban social manners. Why? Because in rustic condition of life, the manners, the norms of behavior come spontaneously out of the feelings and the elementary social contracts and occupations we have. So it is not a very sophisticated life in village. So actually the feelings and the manners correspond, the basic human feelings and the social manners correspond more properly and more reliably in this rustic condition of life. So naturally those manners are more long-standing because they are more related to the essential human conditions and feelings. And naturally such a life suggests itself as an ideal option for a poet. Okay? Now, the last reason. The passions of men are incorporated with the beautiful and permanent forms of nature in that condition, in rustic condition of life. Another drastic looking statement. The passion of men are incorporated, are connected to permanent and beautiful objects. Obviously, he may be referring to lakes, mountains, and such objects of nature. It is associated or it is connected to these beautiful and permanent objects of nature that human passions evolve in a rustic condition of life, and so naturally it is the best. In brief, clubbing these four ideas together, what can we learn? Rustic life is chosen not by accident. It is chosen because that is the best, that is the most ideal option for poetry. So if you deal with the life, if you deal with the social life in an urban condition, there is a problem with that. That's actually the implication we must be aware of. Rural life is romanticized. Rural life is glorified. How? As true life. That's the point. It is there you get the basic human emotions developed. It is there you get the original language spoken. It is there you get the lasting manners exist. It is there that emotions are connected to beauty. This is what he says. And so for these reasons, rustic life, a very clear, overstepping explanation he makes. Now, why language? Because in the object we have seen, not only the rural life is chosen as incidents and situations for his poems, but the rural language, the rustic language also is taken. That means the language really spoken by village people, rustic people. Why that language is opted? He gives us two reasons. These two reasons we will explain a little further and we will revisit when we are to deal with the poetic theory of Wordsworth or Wordsworth's theory of poetic language. And so, but just it needs mention now. Two reasons. One, such men means rustic people. They continuously communicate with the best objects from which the best part of language is originally derived. Exactly one assumption that college questions on two grounds. He says, one, the best part of language is derived from interactions with best objects of nature. That is the first takeaway from this point. And second point, it is in this condition, it is in rustic condition of life that this interaction can be seen. These two points are questioned by Coleridge, because Coleridge argues that the best part of language cannot be said to have developed simply from our interactions with the best objects of nature. Beautiful objects of nature alone is not enough. Education is required, for example. Reading is enhancing for the best part of language, he says. So many other things are there. So social contributions cannot be ignored, according to Coleridge. Anyway, Even if interactions with nature is taken into account, simply by living in the village, you cannot, can you say that such a person interacts with the best objects of nature? So that's a good, anyway, there is a question by Qualitatives. For Wordsworth, the position is clear. It is a rustic person or it is rustic people who interact with the best part of language, best objects of nature, and it is as a result of this interaction that the best part of language derives. So, naturally, the rustic language is the best language. That is the most suitable language for poetry. That's reason number one. Reason number two. I will quote from him. From the rank in society and the sameness and narrow circle of their intercourse, being less under the influence of social vanity, they convey their feelings and notions in simple, unelaborated expressions, which make a permanent and philosophical language. So he comes to the point that rustic language is a permanent and philosophical language, more permanent, more philosophical than any family language of poets. For example, there is a kind of language which poets assume as their territory. You know, a word, if it is used by, for example, you use the word read, that's a common word. If you use the word perusal, it is a fit word for literary expression. That kind of an elevated language is fixed by poets for themselves. And Wordsworth says, more than any such language, the ordinary language spoken by ordinary people in a rustic condition of life, that language is more permanent one, that will be lasting, and that will be a more philosophical language. So because of that superior quality of the rural language, he has decided to choose. That's what he says. So these are the two reasons. Now, before we step into the last two points, just a word in advance. The coming points, in my opinion, are more significant about the romantic criticism, not only because they explain the characteristics of this period, but also some continuity with the movements yet to come. Very often, in the practice of writing or discussing the history of criticism, it is our usual way to contrast romanticism with the later movements. And no one is easily able to think about a point of continuity between romanticism and, say, modernism or new criticism, because at the periphery, they seem to be so contradictory and irreconcilable. But I think the case is not like that. There are certain links. Of course, there are differences. At the same time, Romanticism and Modernism, or Romanticism and the later movements, have a history of continuity as well. And the coming points will be very crucial about this continuity. So, with this word of emphasis, I pass on to the points. So far, Wordsworth has explained, rustic life is chosen, rustic language is chosen. Why? Because rustic life is a true life. Rustic language, because rustic language is a permanent, durable and philosophical language. Okay. Now, he anticipates a question here. The incidents and situations are commonplace. The language also is commonplace. And then what is so exciting about them? He tries to answer with a third point. There is a scope of excitement. There is a scope of aesthetic experience, pleasure. How? Two concepts. The third point actually is an intellectually laden expression, because two concepts are mentioned there. One is imagination. The other is the principle of similitude in dissimilitude. I shall just brief the sentence.
By throwing over certain coloring of imagination, these ordinary things are presented in their unusual aspect. This is how Wordsworth puts it. So, by throwing over them a certain coloring of imagination. So, we must pause and think, what is the romantic idea of imagination? And then, ordinary things presented in their unusual aspect. This is what I called the principle of similitude in dissimilitude as a source of beauty. First, back to imagination. It's true, Wordsworth does not give an articulate definition what imagination is, but his friend gives Coleridge. In Biographia, Coleridge has given the definition, and I think this definition is almost accepted unanimously. There are certain ideas, certain views that Coleridge presents and then unquestionably become accepted. Imagination is one such. Willing suspension of disbelief is another. So, imagination, he considered as a creative power. The usual idea or the commonplace idea about imagination will be as a power to create something non-existent, just to contrive something. Something is not there, so we just say that it is there and there is imagination. But that is not actually the sense in which Coleridge and Wordsworth view that. Imagination is a creative power. Otherwise, two contradictory things are united, and as a result of this union, as a result of this fusion, a new thing is created. Just to take an example from science, hydrogen and oxygen are fused, are united to become water, a new thing which is not hydrogen, which is not oxygen. The two gases unite to form a liquid. So it is not either of them. Again, it is not simply a combination of the both. So an entirely new thing. Such a creative power is what the romantic critics defined as imagination. And as far as Wordsworth does not contradict or does not negate this idea, we can say this idea applies to Wordsworth's concept also. So, by the power of imagination, these ordinary things presented in an unusual aspect, that is actually the two contradictory things, ordinary things, extraordinary aspect, then they are brought together. Naturally, as a result of this imagination, as a result of the application of the imagination, similitude in dissimilitude happens. And similitude in dissimilitude is the secret of pleasure. It is the secret of joy. It's the secret of excitement. Two otherwise contradictory things. So, for example, a complete daylight. No poet has written about the noon as the most beautiful of the time. But every poet writes about the sunset or the dawn. It is a combination of black and white. It's a combination of light and shade. So it is this experience of similitude in dissimilitude that causes beauty, that causes reasonably the experience of aesthetics. And that experience is aimed at. This is what he says. So, while incidents are commonplace, while language is commonplace, by the power of imagination, an unusual aspect of it is brought out. It is like that. And we know, for example, an everyday person in our life, we are not excited about it. But if you view that person, if you happen to see that person in a film, in a movie, or on the newspaper, you will be excited, or you will have an experience of pleasure, you will have an experience of sensation. Because familiarity and unfamiliarity are united. That experience is aimed, targeted in the audience, in the readers, by Wordsworth. That is his Third point. So remember two points: imagination, then the principle of similitude in dissimilitude. And now the last one, the last of the fourfold doctrines, that is, what kind of an interest is aimed? This is a more intellectual part of his view of poetry. What sort of interest? Ordinary things. These are things that you always see in your life, and so particularly not so attractive, or there is nothing so exciting about it. Ordinary language. Again, there is nothing so exciting about it. Then, what is the source of interest you can evoke? He says the interest of knowing something. Knowing what? Again, he clarifies it. Knowing the primary laws of nature, chiefly as far as regards the manner in which we associate ideas in a state of excitement. I will just simplify that. In other words, ordinary events plus human intelligibility. That kind of an interest. If you give a toy train to a young boy, at first he plays with it, and then immediately you can observe the boy's interest is in dissecting it, in trying to know how it operates. Means the boy is trying to apply his intelligibility on the object. So then that object has a peculiar kind of interest. At first his interest was just to play, and that is a very passing, a fleeting one. But a more durable, a more stable interest is created by the second one. That is, when you subject that object to your intelligibility, a durable interest will be excited. And it is that kind of an interest of intelligibility that he is trying to excite in his readers. Intelligibility about what? How you are able to think? How you are able to reach into ideas? You know yourself. So you are actually putting your own mind to your own intelligibility. That is the course of interest. Here he is borrowing an idea from a philosopher. His name is David Hartley. I just take you to two words. One is in this point, he says, the manner in which you associate ideas in a state of excitement. So associate, that word. Then in a state of excitement, that actually correlates to a word which we have already seen in the first paragraph, that is a state of vivid sensation. When he spoke about the experimental nature of the poems, he had mentioned it. So in a state of vivid sensation and excitement are more or less the same mental state. So we can say vivid sensation, and then you associate ideas in such an experience, in such a mental state. How is it happening? To account for it, to explain that. Wordsworth is borrowing from the doctrine of association. Doctrine of association. This was put forward by David Hartley. Remember that name, especially those who plan for UGC NET and JRF. David Hartley was born in 1705, in 18th century, in early 18th century we can see. And he died in 1757. His most celebrated book is Observation on Man, His Frame, His Duty and His Expectations. This was published in 1749 in two parts. Remember that. And it is in this book mainly that David Hartley put forward the idea of, or the doctrine of, association. And the most important point about this doctrine is that it, for the first time perhaps in the history of ideas, tried to explain the process of generating ideas in our mind. Everybody knows human beings are idea making animals. That's one important difference that we make ourselves from other animals. And then, how is this possible? What happens inside us? This question remained unanswered, and for the first time, a name was given and an explanation was attempted by David Hartley. And for that, he used the word association. So, this word is not simply a word, it can be treated as a term. How did Hartley explain the generation of ideas in our mind? It starts from sensations. And then, this sensation creates vibrations and heat. The basic stream of Cartesian philosophy was against emotions in the process of knowledge. That means, even from Plato, there is a stream, and that has been the dominant stream, which believed reason is the opposite of emotion. Knowledge is the opposite of experience. But Hartley's doctrine of association connects them. In this point, we must note, Hartley is not the beginning point, because empiricism starts, at least in a very articulate form, with another man, John Locke. He was in 17th century, 1632. That was his birth year, and then up to 1704. That's a life period. And his name is associated with empiricist philosophy. And that philosophy also pioneered the view that experience is not the opposite of knowledge. You need not distrust or dismiss your experience as untrue and distracting your knowledge. This is a very valid point, and so Romanticism makes use of these philosophical insights and philosophical ideas. That's why the same word is used by Wordsworth. How you are, your mind is associating ideas. In what manner does your mind operate? If that knowledge is given in poems, that will be interesting. That's why I used the term, the poet is subjecting experience to intelligibility, and he is helping the reader to subject his everyday experience to intelligibility. So, the very ordinary things, our own experiences, but we know why, we know how our mind is forming ideas. So, that kind of an interest, that means poetry takes us to the pleasure of the truth. Poetry takes us to the knowledge of our own mind, a universal kind of knowledge. And it is that kind of a novel interest that is aimed at. That is one thing that ensures the quality of the poems as well. So, such an interest is aimed at. That is his last point. This is the fourfold objects proposed by Wordsworth for his poems in Lyrical Ballads. I used his poems because Coleridge had another design, another plan, and that does not match completely with that of Wordsworth. Okay, now with one or two general points, I will conclude this session. The basic point about this romantic criticism, this romantic view, is that they broke away from a legacy that separated or divorced reason and emotion as two irreconcilable forces. Instead, they viewed them as related, linked, one leading to the other. So the basic emotions, the basic experiences in a process of association leads to knowledge, leads to ideas. So, a unifying theoretical approach, we say, instead of the neoclassical separatism, here we see a unifying theory. Everybody knows a word which serves to act as a clue towards his poetical and philosophical approach is transcendentalism. So a transcendental approach is taken by Wordsworth, and this transcendentalism in fact borrows a lot from David Hartley and his doctrine of association. David Hartley also has a reputation of blending both science and religion. Science, because he located mind in the brain. He located the generation of ideas as a physiological process. At the same time, he believed in the universality of human soul. He believed in universal human salvation, which are all basically religious ideas. And these two are connected. My point is this: a long tradition is broken here. A long history, an long intellectual history is broken here. What later developed and flourished to a greater extent takes root here, I say. For example, in 20th century, in the beginning of 20th century, we see more and more insights about the irrational elements that operate in forming ideas, in deciding or determining human actions and thoughts, even in our scientific activities. Romanticism, in a way, takes a pioneering role here. So that traditional binary is in a way overstepped. So that is about the fourfold object Wordsworth proposed for his poems. Thank you for watching me so far. Be prepared for the next video. Thank you for watching me.